relationship with tech than we do today, from the proliferation of social media throughout the world to the undeniable influence of the smartphone in every home. The effects have been revolutionary in both good ways and bad. It's no easy task, but our next group of speakers are going to talk about how and if we can ever balance this love-hate relationship with tech. Please welcome from The Intercept, Murtaza Hussain, Cisco's Executive Chairman John Chambers, Lux Capital Partner Renata Quintini, and Reddit's General Counsel Melissa Tidwell.
Thank you so much, everyone, for attending this event. I think it's one of our best events of this collision. We have a wonderful panel set up today. And the question today, the overarching question, will be, is tech ultimately going to be for good or for bad? And I want to start the conversation by doing a bit of a retrospective. And those of you who remember 10, 15 years ago, when it came to the question of tech, there was a reflexive optimism, and you could call it tech positivity, which over the last decade or so has dissipated due to many high-profile crises that many of us are aware of here. So I wanted to start this discussion with talking first to you, Renata, about the question of tech optimism and how does it relate to trust, and how can we rebuild or establish trust which may have dissipated due to certain events in recent years?
Yeah, so first of all, pleasure to be here. It's a topic that I care a lot about, and I think it's so important because I think we're at a crux that I don't think tech has ever had so much potential and impact. But right now, the questions around is it for good or for bad are at the forefront, and we feel that those can slow down progress and they can destroy value if they're not a tech head up and front. So very happy to be talking about this topic here. So trust and lack of trust is actually a human feeling, right? And tech's now so pervasive. It's everywhere from inside my house to the car I took to come here to the news I consume. And that conversation is also global and it disseminates so quickly. So when I fast forward all this to the idea of more automation, more sensing, more intelligence, and I project, will I lose my job? Will I have my livelihood? And can I trust the information that I get is actually a very stressful time. So it takes me back to humanity and human, and takes me back to the word trust and vulnerability. So I think actually having that dialogue and being open about processes and checks and balances and what you're doing in terms of your product development to actually address that topic is paramount.
Yeah, I agree with you, just to jump on, is that I think, you know, I run legal policy and communications at Reddit, and one of the things we always talk about is that humanity piece of it, right? Like, we talk to our users, we talk to our moderators, we talk to governments. We're a very small company, so that sometimes is hard and time-consuming to do. But I think it makes us sort of who we are as a platform and sets us apart in a different way. I think we're much more transparent because of that.
Right. And John, one thing I wanted to get your perspective on is that working in the tech field at a high level, you have an insight both into the past of this field and in the future, far more so than the end users of the products do. And there are certain crises which have emerged in recent years, which as end users, people are very familiar with, or people who are journalists or people working in the public sphere, they've dealt with the sort of manifestations of. What are some of the crises that you potentially foresee in the future, and how can tech industry get ahead of it and mitigate that, and also ameliorate people's sense of anxiety about what the future may hold since it's unknown to them?
Well, I think we're all in agreement that technology has the potential to change our lives largely in a positive way, but I'd argue that the tech industry as a whole has lost our way over the last couple of years in communicating that. The good thing about having seen each of the transitions over the last 40 years, which I've seen mainframes to mini computers, PC, internet, and digitization, and for 20 years, 1990 through 2010, tech was largely viewed for good. I just came out of the Tech for Good conference with President Macron in France, with other government leaders and the high-tech companies, and I think that optimism is still there. But I think it goes back to we as an industry have to position around trust that both my colleagues mentioned earlier, and trust is track record and relationships. And when problems happen, and we say, well, they've just been recent in terms of the voter issue, et cetera, we saw the same issues 15, 20 years ago with the internet and with an event called Snowden in terms of trust and where the manufacturer is doing things inappropriate. And so your key here is anytime there's a crisis, be very transparent, don't hide. You need to move as an industry, not as individual companies. You need to say what was self-inflicted versus what were bigger issues. You paint the picture of how you're going to come out of it and why this is the right decision overall, and you give people updates regularly. That's where the VC community, startups, people who are doing and have been the large company leads have to come together with this vision.
You know, Melissa, I'm very interested in your perspective at Reddit because as a journalist, we rely very heavily on these public sources of information today. Certain different platforms, Twitter, Facebook, and Reddit is also one of those which are foremost among them. What do you do, or what is you think Reddit does uniquely to build trust among user communities and something that maybe differentiates it from its other peer platforms and makes it more robust and a more reliable source of information in some ways?
Yeah, so Reddit's sort of goal is to bring community and belonging to as many people as we can. I think some of the things that we do are probably happy accidents, one of which was we're a community-based structure, meaning you join a community like Earth Porn, which is beautiful photos of the world. Or if you're really into power washing, there's some communities for you. So I think that community structure where there are volunteer moderators who people are really passionate about particular topics, and creating and setting those rules for that. We as Reddit sit on top of it and have sort of a site-wide policies and sort of we focus on behaviors, what behaviors do we want to see in all of our communities. But I think the community structure is really the fundamental thing that sets us apart. And also the transparent piece. You know, all Reddit user accounts, you can see where they're posting, where are they getting their, you have Reddit karma, where are you getting, and that karma is based on voting and downvoting of what you're posting, and that's public to all users, right? So you can see, and engage when you're engaging with people, you can understand sort of where else are they engaging, why are they engaging there, what are their comments, and when you're having a conversation.
You know, I really like what you said about happy accidents because yeah. I feel that so much of the good that's come out of tech in the last 20 years has been manifestations of things that people were not able to foresee necessarily. The types of connections people have made, the business opportunities, the impacts on politics, many of which have been very positive, they weren't things that people necessarily foresaw when they developed platforms which, like Facebook, for instance, or Twitter, which were intended for very narrow purposes originally. And part of the reason I feel this is because the people who make these platforms, they're technologists, and they come from a very specific field, and both the good and the ill of what they're developing was not necessarily clear to them at the outset. And I was curious, Renata specifically, how can these organizations develop knowledge which allows them to foresee the social consequences of tech? Because we all know how to solve a problem, people in the tech field, but it's very much harder to know how an introduction of a new technology would impact a very complex social and political environment. Are there ways you think we can mitigate that lack of knowledge, and how could that be done?
Yeah, so I think the hiring and the capabilities of your team are really critical. So many companies hire for skill, and can you do X, Y, and Z, and are you the best person suited to solve this particular problem? But problems now are multidimensional, like you said, and you have to think about the second and third order consequences of what you're building. So actually having a diverse team with different backgrounds that will ask different types of questions about the product that you're building is really important. And also the empowering that team for checks and balances throughout the process, right? We have a company in our portfolio that works on geospatial data imagery collection that reviews all the cases annually. You know, what type of data should we collect? What's our policy? How often should we keep the data? Is it exclusive, non-exclusive, et cetera? But everyone in the company, from sales to product development, has a flag that they can raise and bring a question and say, we should talk about this because it may have second or third order impact. And that changes the way you develop products. We have a, when you think about autonomous cars and other companies like that, that, you know, not only the technology is the question, but how it will impact society, you need
but
that
this
diversity.
This is what I think is so important, and you see this change occurring, interestingly enough, with the small companies and the VCs. You see suddenly the venture capitalists say that it's in our financial best interest, as well as tech being for good in the future, to train the young CEOs about understanding the implications of their technology. Using Cisco as an example, did we destroy a lot of jobs in the internet era? Absolutely. Did we create many more jobs than we destroyed? Absolutely. Did we focus on everything from peace in the Middle East to education for the jobs of displacement? Yes. And this is where I think some of the large current players made a major mistake in terms of their technology they provided have both positive and negatives. They needed to focus on both giving back. And when a problem occurs, you've got to be very transparent. You've got to deal with it quickly. You've got to admit how much was self-inflicted and how much not. And I love the fact that many of the leading edge venture capitalists are starting to drill that into the culture of their startups earlier, because that's how you fix it.
Well, and I think, John, to add on to what you're saying, I think what also matters is a little bit of humility when you're having in that crisis sort of context, right? Saying, not just saying we've made a mistake or here's what we did, but having some humility that you're not perfect, that you don't have all the answers, that it's a process and you're struggling through it as well.
And you've got to develop those relationships ahead of time.
Yeah.
You know, in tech for 20 years had no problem with Nancy Pelosi or John McCain, the Democrat or the Republican, had no issue in a major issue in China or India or Europe or Russia. But it was the relationships were built ahead of time. We wouldn't always agree, but we found that issues were mutual benefits. We found a way to navigate through it. So this is one, not just how do you handle a problem once it's there. You can see the problems coming. We know we're going to destroy 20 to 40% of the jobs that exist today with technology. We better get ahead of this one, or that issue will make the current issues look small.
Yeah. Wow.
So when you have a, you know, I think what the core of what you're getting at in some sense too is that tech issues are in some ways driving political change, or in the sense they're drivers of potential political crises or political opportunity. So when you have a forecast like that, which some people could be, you know, it could create anxiety about the future, how do you plan ahead maybe 20 years for the future when maybe 30% of jobs are lost due to tech? And how do you reframe tech as continuing to be a force for good in society when it's not necessarily disrupting in a negative way, but certainly opening up a new vista that people are unfamiliar with? How do you ameliorate that sense of anxiety, especially since companies, of course, they have other motivations too. They're there to sustain themselves and to make profit and so forth. How do you balance this division?
I've had the unique opportunity to be President Macron's French tech ambassador. Can you imagine the U.S. having a German or a French person, our ambassador? And it shows you how countries are changing. He clearly understands the effect of technology, and that's why he did the conference, Tech for Good or Tech for Bad. And he challenged both the large companies and the smaller companies to change it. But if you want one role model in the world that's doing it the best, watch what Prime Minister Modi is doing in India. He's digitizing his entire country. He understands the importance of startups will be where jobs will be created. He knows the large companies probably will not add headcount during the next decade. He's saying, how does he make this inclusive across 29 states and 1.3 billion people? And he's probably going to win this election, which people thought he may not even win. You know, 6 months ago, he may even win with a majority. But he built his program around what technology can do, and then he holds the technology companies candidly accountable for the results, and he has literally a scorecard that each of his governors or chief ministers, as they're called there, report to. So he knows what the startups do, he knows what the VCs do, he knows what the established companies do.
You know, I this question is for anyone on the panel who wants to ask it. I think that what you're getting at too is very important, because knowledge and access to these platforms is a very important vector of power today. And this power has diffused itself around the world, and including countries where 20, 30 years ago, there was a great disparity. So for instance, China or Russia, for instance, has access to technology which they didn't, and in many ways puts them on par with the United States. And their political cultures are not progressive in the sense that they're not democratic, and they open up these technologies to potential abuses, and in some cases in China, you're seeing current abuses. Is there a way of making tech something which is has the progressiveness of it built in, or protections in those platforms to prevent this? Because I fear that there's also, and this is necessarily not a crisis which will necessarily happen, but forecasting from an end user perspective, there's a fear that what if these platforms, which 20 years ago we saw as inherently positive, become tools for authoritarian control? Is there a way of negating this, or does some way this is inherently a risk in the development of powerful platforms like this?
I mean, I think it gets back a little bit to what you were saying earlier, which is to ask the hard questions, right? As companies, I think you have to have a value set, right? Like, what do you really believe in? What do you stand for? What are the lines that you're willing to draw or not willing to draw? And I think when you have that value standpoint, or sort of that moral, that company moral base, then I think it helps you address those questions. If you're asking yourself the hard questions and you have a moral base, when you get to the hard question of what do I think about, you know, are you going to enter the Chinese market, or you know, how do you feel about dealing, you know, with X government? I think you have a better, clear sense as to how, as a company, you would behave, right? Because I think it does depend on the technology, and I think the important part is the companies not only, you know, are transparent and ask themselves the hard questions, but think about if this, asking yourself the hard questions is saying, if this happened, how would we respond? Right. As a company, how do we actually feel about X? What are our core values? For us as Reddit, one of our core values is transparency, is openness, and is the power of real and hard conversation.
Yeah. You want to have that discussion before the problem occurs.
Exactly. Yeah.
You want to say, what is your culture? And we're really a culture question here. Yeah. My views on it are pretty strong.
Yeah.
I think you give no unique capability to any country in the world, including our own. And if you give something to somebody, you give it to everybody. But we've got to be very careful. If we begin to, as technology companies, instill our views on other people around the world, including within the U.S. as an example, Silicon Valley made a terrible mistake of telling a large part of the U.S., get used to it. Yeah, and you've got a problem here. We're going to tell you our voting pattern. You don't understand. And when you talk down to people who, for the first time in American history, no longer believe they will have a better life than their parents, who no longer believes that their children will have a better life than them, and these technology companies are threatening to destroy their jobs, and then they're telling you how you should vote, that is just plain wrong. And so we've got to be very careful that we shouldn't impose our values, our political views on others, and be transparent. But I think if we go back to the basics, the culture, you teach it from the first startups, you build it into them, is tech for good, and you expect to create more jobs than you destroy, then I think the other things we can navigate together. But we've got to do it as a group.
Yeah,
it
can't
be each of us doing it individually, the VCs, the startups, the large companies.
Yeah, and as you're raising capital for your startup, be upfront about those values, what you want to accomplish, and make sure the VC that you choose is also on board. Because we see so many...
Because you're going to need their support at some point.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And that idea of growth at all costs, right? If you're going to get pushed to make trade-offs in the short term to keep on growing, that person is clearly not a good partner for you, not aligned with your overall goals of building a long-term sustainable tech for good company.
You know, it's going to be interesting, and this is beyond the scope of the panel, but what we're alluding to is capitalism is going to have to change. My view is yes. It's got to be capitalism with a social conscience. And you've got to build that into the companies and directions. If we don't, government will re-regulate us.
Right. Yeah, right.
And so we'll be asking for trouble if we don't make it part of the changes.
Yeah.
You know, this question is also, I think it's a very key point you raised right now, too. And this question is for all of you. It's that when there's a question of values, is there the potential for the industry as a whole to move with one voice in some degree? Or does that exist today? Or do we see more of a fragmented environment where some companies are doing something and some others? And is there a possibility for harmonization in a positive direction, a progressive direction?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I'm on the board of the Internet Association, which is one of the trade associations that represent the broad internet. And I think the challenge with moving forward to date has been that the internet itself is so broad, right? You have self-driving cars, you have blockchain, you have healthcare companies, you have core software companies, you have the hardware companies. And so I think, you know, I think tech could do a lot better in terms of, one of the things we focus on is trying to make sure that we're all talking and having the conversations. I think there is actually a lot of alignment. And I think, you know, one of the things that we're sort of pushing on is ensuring that that alignment is not just sort of the big companies that are in the news today, but more broadly across smaller companies, and making sure that that what's coming forth is the tech, what you talk about, like sort of the tech perspective, right? How do we grow entrepreneurship? How do you grow companies? How do you sort of do tech for good and also sort of consider like the smaller players and allow new companies to develop?
And if you think about it, right, thinking about trust and thinking about building your company in a different way, the big established companies, they are the incumbents now.
Yeah.
And it's going to fall on the smaller new companies, the startups, and the people that are funding companies early to change the rules of the game. So actually coalescing and talking and you know, building the wave of the future is going to be really important.
Yeah.
One of the advantages of being in the industry for multiple decades is I've seen most of these movies before. And the early 90s, Silicon Valley's attitude toward Washington and governments around the world is arm's length, don't get involved, huge mistake. TechNet was founded to begin to get the companies to work together toward a common goal. I strongly believe that the technology companies, both the big, the small, and the VCs, don't come together and get ahead of this, you're going to see regulation and you're going to see monopolistic practices, and what today is viewed as the exception by government will actually become the rule. Most governments around the world really don't want to regulate because they know they can't get ahead of this. But if the technology companies don't do it themselves and don't work with a common front to government, then you're going to see a lot of changes, in my opinion, mainly for bad.
Yeah.
So I think we have to come together.
Yeah.
So we've got about 2 minutes left. I wanted to just contextualize, too, because I'm so glad we had this panel. I think it's one of the most important panels they've had at Collision this year. The Silicon Valley is really the newest and in many ways the most important center of power in the United States today, in the world really. You had Wall Street in previous generations, you had Texas oil fields, you have Washington DC, political power of course. The Silicon Valley is the newest and it's still developing its own culture, and the decisions which are made today which will have generations long impacts. So with about 30 seconds left for each of you, I want you to quickly tell me, tech for good, tech for bad, and why, in your view. And you can just tell me in the sense of why you're optimistic, because I know you are all optimistic from talking to you about this for quite a while now.
I mean, I think I'll obviously go with tech for good. I think fundamentally why I am optimistic is that, you know, I think product development is truly amazing and sort of what has been able to exist, right? I think, you know, one of the things that brought me to Reddit was a user who was in Syria posting in a community about not just that he was in a war-torn country, but also that he was gay and sort of the pressure that he felt in that country. And I think the ability to both see him talk about that on a platform on Reddit and to see users around the world say, here's what the UN says about sort of being a protected, you know, you can get refugee. If you can get to Brighton, England, I'll give you a job in my hotel, right? Random strangers on the internet connecting and trying to sort of make another human's life better. That doesn't exist without technology. Right. And I think to me, it still gives me goosebumps. And I think, you know, I think it's ultimately beneficial.
Yeah, so I mean, at Lux, we invest in companies that are out of sci-fi movies, and it's really using the best in technology and science to solve the biggest human problems, matters that matter. So all the way from computational drug discovery to autonomous cars and so many things in between. And if you think about leveraging all that to help forward society and help reduce human suffering, make humans live better, that's amazing. So I think the ball is in our court now to make it work for our benefit, and because I think it will adapt, right? The changes will be tough. They will adapt, but let's make it less friction and less painful and as valuable as soon as possible.
I think we're all three in agreement that tech, if done right, is for good, but it requires us to gain control of our own destiny. We have to deal with the issues that are fair challenges from government and from society, and I think we've got to rewrite it. But it's no longer going to be Silicon Valley. I was out of Boston 128 MIT. That was the Silicon Valley of 30 years ago.
Yeah.
I would not assume that the Silicon Valley of today will be the leader globally. I think LA, Austin, Texas, New York, Toronto has the chance to lead. So I think it's more of the tech community on a global basis coming together as opposed to one geographic place.
Right. No. Well, thank you so much, and thank you to our brilliant panelists. I thought this was a very fruitful discussion.
Thank you.
Thanks for taking the time.
We walk up the same way.